Now, as population ecologists, we want to predict rates of population growth, and now we recognize that we have to have a more complex view of populations. And so we need to be using density-dependent equations. What we'll be looking at is how the population changes through time. And so a change in population through a change in time, dn dt, we will describe as being n, that's our population size, times r, the intrinsic growth rate, times this little factor called k minus n divided by k. Okay? This k minus n divided by k is a simple algebraic representation of the proportion of resources that have not yet been used up or not being consumed by our population. Now, to think about this intuitively, all we need to do is to set n equals to zero, so there's essentially nobody in the population, and this term k minus zero divided by k is equal to one. And now we have population growth rate being exponential because r is the only thing that's influencing the growth. But when n equals k, now this term k minus n is equal to zero, and so there's no more resources left, and growth comes to a halt. When n exceeds k, this little algebraic term becomes a negative number, and the population will decline back down towards the carrying capacity. So k minus n divided by k is a very simple algebraic tool to capture the essence of what we need in a density-dependent equation. Now, looking at this graphically, we have our logistic growth equation, where the change in population through time equals this n times r times k minus n divided by k. And as the population grows, the population approaches this upper limit, this carrying capacity of k, and the so-called environmental resistance to further population growth gets stronger and stronger, trying to hold down that growth. So at very low population densities, population is essentially zero, k minus n is essentially k, so this term is one, population growth is more or less exponential. But as we approach the carrying capacity, this term now is zero, so growth, the further increment upwards, goes to zero and the population growth halts. Now, it's interesting to contemplate what happens in different populations according to how rapidly they can inherently grow upwards. The logistic population growth is a very good description of populations with very low r. If r is only about 0.4, as in this lower curve here, population does show that nice logistic relationship, rapid population growth then slowing down as it approaches k. If r is equal to 0.8, it approaches that carrying capacity more quickly, but then it stabilizes and stays at k. So it's a nice smooth arrival at the carrying capacity. So when r is small, the population will ease towards the carrying capacity. If population growth is more rapid, so if r is equal to 1.8, the population may overshoot at first, but the next generation, when the population is above the carrying capacity, this term is going to be negative, the population declines, but it eventually makes a nice little landing again on the carrying capacity. So that's a damped oscillation around k. Where r is even higher, the population overshoots so much, it gets thrown back below the carrying capacity so far that infinitely it goes above and below, back and forth, around the carrying capacity. And so we have cyclical population oscillations. And these are actually observed. It's well known in a very important agricultural pest, the pine moth, here in the US, that pine moth outbreaks can be predicted. They're every 5 or 6 years that follow this cyclical population oscillation. And if population growth is even more rapid, where r is about 3 or so, then the population number may seem almost random from 1 year to the next. It overshoots so far, it may go way far below the next year, but then not quite make it. It's all around the place. Now, there are real examples of chaotic population sizes in organisms with very rapid growth. Measles is a virus that doesn't affect your generation at all, but back in the 1940s and 50s was a very chronic and a serious childhood disease. It's a virus spread by sneezing, and it would come and go in a population almost at random. This is especially clear in this bottom graph of Great Yarmouth down here, where there might not be any measles for a while, and then suddenly a boom, a big bang, and then not sure when it's going to come back, bang, it's back again. So you have this chaotic behavior of the measles outbreaks in this particular area. And this is also something we see in weeds. Some years you see a whole lot of a particular kind of annoying weed, and other years they're not around very much, and it seems kind of random. Well, in fact, it will be random if R is sufficiently high. And that's something we see here in Minnesota with the annual bluegrass. Now, some species have much higher rates of intrinsic growth than others, and to a large extent this can be explained by their size. So things that are very, very big have a very slow generation time. So beech trees take decades before they mature. Cows mature in years, rats in months, beetles in days, etc., etc. These down even in hours. Smaller things tend to have much, much higher intrinsic growth rates. And these are the things that we actually associate with chaotic population changes. Sometimes they have an outbreak of E. coli, sometimes they have an outbreak of Hydra and Paramecium, other times they're not around. Rats and those gypsy moths show cycles, but these other larger things rather smoothly go up and approach their carrying capacity. So we may have these density-dependent factors affecting our populations, but there's one other factor we need to know about before we move on. And that is that population growth can also be influenced by what are called density-independent factors. And these are like ecological disasters or catastrophes that affect population size regardless of its density. So you might have a fire, a storm, a drought, a flood, even an avalanche that will wipe out all the small organisms in a particular area regardless of how many there were. So there are cases where populations may rarely approach the carrying capacity. And this is something that's most common in very small species. Small animals can't get out of the way of that fire, whereas the deer could go stand in the water. Big animals can stand up to the floods, little animals get drowned. So this is something we expect to see that's more important in small species being subject to these density-independent factors than our very large ones. So what we've been trying to get through so far is that species vary in their intrinsic growth rate and their exposure to density-dependent population limitations.